Hi, I am Professor Tian. I am a macroeconomist. These days, virtually all economies around the world are integrated into the larger world economy. We wear clothes made in Vietnam. We eat strawberries from Chile, avocados from Mexico. We use computers and phones with chips made in China. And we drive cars with parts imported from Canada. We're able to enjoy all these wonderful things from different parts around the world because all countries have extensive trading relationships with other countries.
In order to understand how these international exchanges happen, both in terms of the flow of capital and the flow of goods and services, we need to first understand movements in the exchange rate. What is an exchange rate? I will answer that question in this short video. We will go over the definition of nominal and real exchange rates, as well as some examples to see how they are different and how they can be used. Let's start with the definition. Exchange rate is the rate at which we can trade one currency for another, or the rate we can exchange domestic goods for foreign goods. When we exchange currencies, say $1 for 100 Japanese yen, this 1-to-100 ratio is a nominal exchange rate. When we exchange goods, say one American Big Mac for one French Big Mac, this 1-to-1 ratio is a real exchange rate. Let's start our exploration of exchange rates by looking at the nominal exchange rate. This is the exchange rate that you see quoted in financial news, or the exchange rate that you deal with when you are traveling abroad and trying to exchange US dollars for foreign currency. Exchange rates are bilateral, meaning that it can be quoted in two different ways. For example, we can quote the nominal exchange rate between US dollar and Japanese yen as 100, that is 100 yen for one US dollar. Or we can quote the same nominal exchange rate as 0.01, which means we just need one US penny for one Japanese yen. In this video, I will be consistent with the definition used in your textbook and define nominal exchange rate E as units of foreign currency needed to purchase one unit of domestic currency, with the US dollar as the domestic currency. Given this definition of nominal exchange rate E, when E increases, we say that the US dollar has appreciated in value. If E equals to 100 to start with, a higher E means that it takes more than 100 yen to exchange for one US dollar. So the US dollar is worth more than before. Conversely, when E decreases, the US dollar depreciates in value. A E lower than 100 means that the same US dollar gets you less than 100 yen now. Hence, the US dollar is worth less. So how is the nominal exchange rate determined? Just like a lot of other economic variables, the nominal exchange rate is determined in a competitive market through supply and demand. You can think about the nominal exchange rate as the price of currencies. So supply and demand for that currency will determine its price. The market in which currencies are traded is called the foreign exchange market, or forex market. Now let's talk about the real exchange rate. Whenever we label something real in economics, it means the unit of measurement for this variable is no longer in monetary terms. Real exchange rate tells us the relative price of domestic goods to foreign goods. In other words, it describes the amount of foreign goods you can purchase by giving up one unit of domestic good. Note that the definition of the real exchange rate parallels the definition of the nominal exchange rate, units of foreign goods per unit of domestic good. Economists use the lowercase letter q to denote the real exchange rate. So how do we calculate Q? Mathematically, we need the nominal exchange rate and relative prices to calculate it. So Q equals to E times P over P star. P is the domestic price level, and P star is the foreign price level. Let's use an example to help you understand this better. Let E equals to 100, that is 100 Japanese yen buys one US dollar. Now, suppose the price of Big Mac in the US is equal to $5. That's our domestic price, P. And the price of Big Mac in Japan is equal to 400 yen. That's the foreign price, P star. Putting these numbers into the formula for Q, we can calculate Q as 100 times 5 divided by 400, which is equal to 1.25. Note that the numerator, E times P, gives us the price of Big Mac in the US in Japanese yen, which is equal to 500 yen in our example. The denominator is just the price of Big Mac in Japan in yen, which is 400 yen in our example. So when we divide the US Big Mac price in yen by the Japanese Big Mac price in yen, we get the relative exchange ratio between the Big Macs. Therefore, a real exchange rate of 1.25 means that we need 1.25 Japanese Big Mac to exchange for 1 US Big Mac. Given this numerical example, whose Big Mac is cheaper? Japan's, of course, since we can exchange 1 US Big Mac for more than 1 Japanese Big Mac. The real exchange rate is a useful tool to gauge the relative value of goods and determine if there is arbitrage opportunity. When Q is equal to 1, the goods are exactly the same value between countries. So 1 Big Mac in the US gets you 1 Big Mac in Japan. No gain to swap one for the other. If Q is greater than 1, then 1 Big Mac in the US gets us more than 1 Big Mac in Japan. So it's a great deal to swap the US Big Mac for Japanese Big Macs, since you can get more than 1 for 1. Conversely, if Q is less than 1, then 1 Big Mac in the US gets less than 1 Big Mac in Japan. In this case, the Japanese will benefit if they swap their Big Macs for US Big Macs, because Japanese Big Macs is more valuable than ours. With this interpretation for the real exchange rate, we say the US dollar experiences real appreciation if Q rises and real depreciation if Q declines. Because exchange rates can be quoted in two different ways, it can get incredibly confusing. So get into the habit of quoting exchange rates with units attached. For example, instead of just saying E is equal to 100, say that E is 100 yen for 1 US dollar. Similarly, instead of simply stating Q is equal to 1.25, say the real exchange rate is 1.25 Japanese burger for 1 US burger. When you specify the units, either in your head or out loud, it helps you remember the definition and helps you interpret the exchange rate appropriately. Having a good understanding of exchange rate not only helps you understand the economics of trade flow, but it is also useful on a practical level. When you travel abroad, you need to figure out how much foreign currency to exchange. Knowing the typical value of a currency and taking advantage of favorable exchange rates can save you lots of money. For example, if, say, the long-run average value of Japanese yen to US dollar is 100 yen per dollar, but for some reason, currently the yen is trading at 120 yen per dollar, that's like getting a 20% discount on Japanese yen. So it might be a good time to think about taking advantage of this favorable exchange rate and exchange some of your US dollar for Japanese yen. Similarly, you can exploit the favorable exchange rates to get some terrific shopping deals. It is possible that the same iPhone is selling for less in Japan when you convert its yen price to US dollars. So iPhones in Japan become a great deal if you can get your hands on one.
I hope you have enjoyed our discussion of exchange rates. This is a super exciting area in macroeconomics to learn about. Now go out there and keep an eye on exchange rate movements and relative prices, and see if you can spot some great deals out there to take advantage of.